Every person in our world is heading toward eternal life or eternal death. Bible prophecy tells us we are living in the last days of Earth's history, when every person's eternal destiny is to be decided. The purpose of Steps to Life Television is to help you make the decisions you must make if your destiny is to be eternal life.
Have you noticed the increased lawlessness all over the country? Have you noticed the developing attitude of hatred against law by large people groups? The big question is, what will be the end of this? Bible prophecy speaks very specifically about the problem of law and order in the last days and what will happen and what will it develop into. Before we look at that, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to read. Father in heaven, as we open your holy book and read what you have predicted to happen in our time, we humbly but earnestly pray that your Spirit will teach us and help us to understand what we need to know to be ready for the future. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's free book is entitled, Does God's Grace Blot Out the Law? To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer DGG. Bold robberies and murder fill the news. People know that these things break the laws of the land. But how many people understand about God's law? To receive your free copy of Does God's Grace Blot Out the Law, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer DGG. And now, Pastor John Grosbaugh.
In Matthew 24, when Jesus' disciples asked him what would be the sign of his coming and of the end of the world, Jesus gave a detailed prophecy about conditions in the world that would occur in the last days. I want to read to you just one verse about Jesus' prophecy about law and order in the last days. This is in Matthew 24, verse 12. It says, because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. So, there is going to be an abundance. Jesus said, lawlessness will abound. And as a result of that, the love of many, the spiritual experiences of many Christians will grow cold, will disappear. Now, this prediction of lawlessness in the last days is dwelt upon in detail by Bible prophets and apostles. For example, the Apostle Paul speaks of the mystery of lawlessness that will envelop the world in the last days. You can read that in 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 7 to 12. And the Apostle John in Revelation 13 speaks decidedly about a worldwide lawlessness that will develop in the last days. In fact, according to Revelation 13, this spirit of lawlessness will reach an extent where the most powerful governments in the world and the most powerful churches in the world will attempt to force everyone in the world to break the law of God. In order for this to happen, as is predicted in the latter part of Revelation 13, there would have to develop in the world a spirit of hatred toward the law of God. Hatred of the law of God, then, is one of the prophetic biblical signs that we are approaching the end of the world. Do we see a hatred developing against all of God's commandments today? Well, let's take a look. The first commandment says, you shall not have any other gods before me. So man is forbidden to give to any other object the first place in his affections or his service. What we cherish tends to either increase or decrease our love for God. And so, if we cherish something above God, then of that we do make a god. But in the last days, the Bible predicts that people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, and lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. You can read that in 2 Timothy 3. Now, the second commandment forbids the worship of the true God by images or similitudes. It's not talking about false gods so much. It's talking about trying to worship the true God with images or similitudes. Idolatry, being spiritual adultery, the displeasure of God against it is fitly called in the Bible jealousy. Today, hundreds of millions of Christians break this commandment every week. And there is going to be such hatred against this commandment in the future that there will be an attempt to force every single person in the world to break this commandment, according to Revelation 13. Now, the third commandment forbids the taking of false oaths. It says, "You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain." This commandment forbids us taking the name of God on our lips in a light or trifling manner, using it, as people use it to swear with, using it without regard to its awful significance. It is a sad thing to realize that this commandment is broken all over the Christian world today. Now, the fourth commandment commands us to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, and tells us explicitly that the Sabbath is the seventh day of the week. The Sabbath was instituted before sin entered the world, as you can read in Genesis 2. And the Sabbath was enjoined by the apostles long after the cross, as you can read in Hebrews 4 or 1 Corinthians 7. It is predicted, however, that someday the entire world is going to worship God on the seventh day of the week. You can read that in Isaiah 66. And yet, even though the Bible predicts that, yet today, not only the great majority of the Christian world is breaking the Sabbath every week, but a hatred against the Sabbath is developing in many parts of the world. And then there is the fifth commandment. The fifth commandment commands us to honor our father and our mother. But the Bible predicts, you can read it in 2 Timothy 3:2, one of the signs of the last days is that children will be disobedient to their parents. You can read in Romans 1, God considers breaking of the fifth commandment to be worthy of death. This commandment is hated and despised today. In fact, there are organizations that will help young people to keep unsavory information concealed from their parents. The parents, of course, will find all of this out in the final day of judgment, because the Bible says that God's going to reveal every secret thing in the judgment. You can read that in Ecclesiastes 12 or in Romans 2. Paul says God is going to judge the secrets of men. So, in that day, the parents will understand not only what their children have done, but why their children are not saved. And then there is the sixth commandment. Now, the sixth commandment says, "You shall not murder, you shall not kill." So, this commandment is broken all over the world today. When I was a child, it was abhorred that when we studied history, that there were ancient nations that practiced human sacrifices as part of their religion. And that was considered to be horrible evidence of the terrible effect of idolatry. Now, today, we do not offer sacrifices of children. We kill the children before they're born. And the most popular movies today are those that are depicting violent killing. Now, my friend, it is a law of the mind that by beholding, we become changed. So what people are watching is bringing the moral level of the human race lower than it has ever been. And then there is the seventh commandment. which says, "You shall not commit adultery." Now, the seventh commandment has been hated by mankind for many, well, I guess thousands of years. In ancient times, the seventh commandment was often broken. But the people breaking the seventh commandment in ancient times knew that they were breaking a command of God and that God pronounced it a crime worthy of death. But approximately 250 years ago, some forms of breaking the seventh commandment began to be explained as being all right for some people in certain situations. As time went on, more and more ways of committing adultery were explained as being all right, so that today, all six forms of committing adultery that are prohibited in Leviticus 18 are considered to be all right. And then there is the eighth commandment. The eighth commandment forbids man-stealing, slave-dealing. It forbids wars of conquest. It says, "Thou shalt not steal." Of course, it forbids theft and robbery. It forbids overreaching in trade. It requires us to pay just debts and wages. It forbids us from taking advantage of the ignorance or weakness or misfortune of somebody else. All that kind of activity is recorded in the books of heaven as fraud, opposite our name if we do it. And then there is the ninth commandment. The ninth commandment says, "You shall not bear false witness." Every attempt or purpose to deceive is forbidden in this commandment. The use of misrepresentation to our advantage is forbidden in this commandment. Now, the question is, when you look at all the commandments, we've looked at 9 out of 10, when you look at all the commandments, you see that not only are they almost universally broken, but there is actually a hatred against them. People hate this law. They wish it didn't even exist. And as the Bible predicts, the hatred against the law of God will develop to such an extent that the time is coming when the most powerful governments in the world and the most powerful churches in the world are going to attempt to force every single person in the world to break God's commandments, as you can read in the latter part of Revelation 13. The bigger question is, what is going to happen to people that do this? What is going to happen to the people that keep breaking God's commandments? Will there be people that will be breaking God's commandments right up to the end of the world? Well, yes, there will be. But then what is going to happen? Stay tuned, we'll see.
Bible prophecy has accurately predicted the future of churches and nations hundreds and thousands of years in advance. Bible prophecy is the only dependable guide to what is really going to happen in the future and how to get ready for it. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence Course lessons will help you understand Bible prophecy and Bible teaching about how you can be ready for the future. These lessons can be sent to your home without cost to you, or you can study the lessons online. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH to enroll or log on to our website at www.stepstolife.org.
Welcome back. What is going to happen to people that go on breaking the law of God? They say, "Well, I'm confessing my sins every night." Well, let's read what happens if you go on and live in sin even though you're confessing your sins every night. We'll read the words of Jesus about it, because Jesus told a powerful parable about this very problem in Matthew 13. Here's what he said. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servants of the owner came and said to him, 'Sir, did not you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares?' He said to them, 'An enemy has done this.' The servant said to him, 'Do you want us then to go and gather them up?' But he said, 'No, lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, first gather together the tares and bind them into bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Notice Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like a field where you have wheat growing, but you also have tares growing, and the tares are planted by an enemy. And what's going to happen? Well, they're both going to grow together. It's not up to us to choose which plant is wheat and which plant is a tare. Jesus said, let them both grow together until the end, until the harvest. And when the harvest comes, I will send forth the reapers, and they'll gather together the tares first and bind them in bundles. Okay? And then the wheat will be gathered into my barn. Now the disciples were troubled about what this parable meant. And so they asked Jesus later when he was alone, and the multitude had gone away and they were talking to him privately. They said to him, well, please explain this parable to us. What does this parable about the wheat and the tares mean? Now, when Jesus explained the parable, I'll read his explanation, and you will see immediately, Jesus tells them, this parable reveals what is going to happen to the people that go on living lawless lives, living in sin until the end of the world. Notice what Jesus said when he explained this parable. This is Matthew 13, verses 36 to 43. It says, then Jesus sent the multitude away and went into the house. And his disciples came to him, saying, explain to us the parable of the tares of the field. He answered and said to them, he who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seeds are the sons of the kingdom. But the tares are the sons of the wicked one. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of this age. Notice carefully now, verse 41. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Notice what Jesus is saying here. Right now, the righteous and the wicked are all mixed together, all over the world. But the time is coming when the Son of Man is going to come back to this world, and he's going to send out his angels, and they're going to separate the righteous from the wicked, and the wicked, those that are living in lawlessness. Did you notice that? Those that are offensive, those that are living in lawlessness, they're breaking God's law, they're going to be cast into a furnace of fire. That's what Jesus said. That's the parable of the wheat and the tares. You can read both the parable and the explanation in Matthew 13. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus gave a rather detailed explanation about what he's going to say to these tares that are cast into the fire. Before they're cast into the fire, many of them are going to be saying, well, Lord, you've made a mistake. That can't be me. I know I'm saved because I was a church member, and I was even working miracles in your name, and I was doing many things in your service. So I received the Holy Spirit, and so I know that I'm saved. Notice what Jesus is going to say to these tares that think that they're saved. This is in Matthew 7, verses 21 to 23. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? I had the gift of prophecy, Lord. I know I'm saved. Cast out demons in your name. Lord, I could cast out demons in your name, so I know I'm saved. I had the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what they'll say. And I did many wonders in your name. That's Matthew 7:22. So these are people that could cast out demons. They could prophesy, and they were working many miracles, many wonders in Christ's name. And they say, I have to be saved. How can you do this? How can you say this? Notice what Jesus will say to them. This is in verse 23. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. What's the problem? Jesus said, you're practicing lawlessness. You're violating the law of God. You claimed that you were one of my followers, but you were living in lawlessness. You were violating the law of God. You are not a loyal subject of my kingdom. I never knew you. My dear friend, if you are living in lawlessness, the record of the Bible is that you don't know Jesus and he doesn't know you. Now, he knows who you are. He knows what you're doing, but he does not know you in the sense of having a relationship with you. Jesus will say to these people, depart from me. I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. My dear friend, Jesus predicted here in the Sermon on the Mount that that was going to happen to many, many people. Many people will think that they're saved, but they will come right up to the end and they'll find out that they're lost because they claim to be Christians, but they did not have a regard for the law of God. They weren't keeping it. They weren't teaching others to keep it. They were fighting against it. When the big governments of the world and the big churches of the world try to persuade everybody in the world to break the law of God, they'll go right along with it. But the result of that is that they'll lose their soul. Let me ask you a question that a lot of people haven't thought of, haven't thought through. The question is this. Why did Jesus even come to this world and die on the cross? Why did he do that? Well, people say, he did that so that he could forgive my sins. Well, that's true, but that's not the only reason. Why did he come and die on the cross? Why did he come to this world and die on the cross to save you from your sins? And sin, remember, is a transgression of God's law. Notice what the Apostle Paul says about this. In the book of Titus, the Apostle Paul is writing to a young minister. And this is what he says, Titus 2. He says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. He came to this world and died on the cross for us. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. Oh, friend, have you been redeemed from every lawless deed? If you're still living in lawlessness, you have not yet been redeemed from every lawless deed. Jesus came to this world to die on the cross, not so that people could have a license to do whatever they pleased and break the law of God. He came and died on the cross to redeem us from every lawless deed. That's called repentance, when we're sorry for what we've done and we want to be forgiven. We're sorry enough to quit our lawlessness. Let me ask you this question. What is the attitude of Jesus Christ towards lawlessness? From what we've studied so far in the Bible, it should be very evident, but I'll read you a text now that tells explicitly what Jesus Christ's attitude is toward lawlessness. If you claim to be a Christian, you need to understand this. This is in the book of Hebrews, the first chapter, and verses 8 and 9. This is God the Father talking to God the Son. You can see that from the context. It says, but to the Son, he says, that's the Father, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions. Notice, it says concerning Jesus, the Father speaking to the Son. He says, you have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Did you get that? Jesus hates lawlessness. Jesus hates lawlessness. Now, here's the trouble. What Jesus hates, the carnal, unconverted man loves. People in this world love to sin. That's why they do it. They love it. But the end of that kind of life is death. We just read in the Bible that the day will come. All the lawless people will perish. In the new earth that God is going to create in this world someday, there won't be one single lawless person in it. The only people in the new earth will be those that keep God's commandments. So the Bible says that very clearly in the book of Revelation. Notice what it says in Revelation 22, verses 14 and 15. Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into the city. But outside are dogs and sorcerers and sexually immoral and murderers and idolaters and whoever loves and practices a lie. Notice, in the new world that God is going to create, the only people that will be residing in it are those that have been keeping God's commandments, not those who have been living a lawless life. How is it with you today, friend? Have you surrendered your heart to the Lord and said, Lord, here I am. All I have is a wicked heart to give to you. I want to be born again. I want to die to my wicked self, and I want to be born again by the Holy Spirit. I want a new heart, a heart that loves your law and wants to do it and wants to keep it. Has that been your experience? My dear friend, you must be born again if you're going to be in the kingdom of heaven. Our old heart of stone that loves to break the law of God must be crucified, and we must be born again of the Holy Spirit. We must receive a new heart and a new spirit who loves to keep God's law. Have you had that experience yet?
We all face one of two different destinies, eternal life or eternal death. We want to help you take the necessary steps so that your destiny will be eternal life. We worship the God who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and rested on the Sabbath. You're invited to worship with us every Sabbath at 11 a.m. Central Time at our chapel at 9330 East Prairie Meadows Circle, Derby, Kansas, on Webb Road, 1/2 mile south of 47th Street, or online at www.stepstolife.org.
We hope you've enjoyed today's program. Today's free book is entitled, Does God's Grace Blot Out the Law? To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer DGG. Many people today are living a lawless life. Bold robberies and murder fill the news on a daily basis. People know that these things break the laws of the land, but how many people understand about God's law? Many people today believe that because of God's grace, we no longer have to keep God's law. But is this true? What does God's Word have to say on this subject? To receive your free copy of Does God's Grace Blot Out the Law? Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer DGG. From all of us here at Steps to Life Ministries, may God richly bless you.
We hope you are choosing life as your eternal destiny. Steps to Life exists to help people choose life instead of death. We would love to hear from you. You can join us for worship on Saturdays at 11 a.m. Central Time at 9330 East Prairie Meadows Circle, Derby, Kansas, or write to Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278, or call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Or email us at historic@stepstolife.org. Our web address is www.stepstolife.org.